Our general goal is to understand what type of problems we can solve with what type of computational resource and what amount of those resources we need. A lot of the time, when we talk about computational resources, we really mean computational time, so how long does it take to compute something. Sometimes we also mean memory, how much memory do we need to compute something. Next, we want to talk about something that feels quite different. We want to consider if and how randomization can be used in computation. Being allowed to use randomization might not at first seem like being allowed to use some extra computational resource. Often we don't think about randomization in that way. But I would argue that you can see randomization, access to randomization, as some type of computational resource, as some type of access to an extra computational resource. And one way of seeing this is that you can really buy hardware products that do nothing but provide you with random bits. These are USB sticks or PCI cards you can put into your computer, and they will just provide your computer with a constant stream of random bits. So if you can buy hardware, physical hardware, that does nothing but provide you with random bits, then surely this feels like a computational resource, right? It's an extra resource you provide. Such devices are based on different techniques to generate those random bits. So one way of doing this, for example, is you can shoot photons onto a semi-transparent mirror and then measure whether the photon was reflected from the mirror or went through. And that basically gives you a random bit. So you say we have a 0 if it's reflected and a 1 if it goes through the mirror. Most of the time, we are happy to not have access to a real physical device that generates such good random numbers. And instead, we use something called a pseudo-random number generator, which is really just a deterministic process, kind of an algorithm that produces numbers that look random but really are not. For many applications, pseudo-random number generators are completely sufficient, and you don't need these extra hardware devices and true sources of randomness. However, there are some applications where you want to be extra careful, for example, in cryptography or things like that. There are two different ways in which we can think about randomness in our computational model. So one way of thinking about this is to define a different type of Turing machine. So before we had deterministic Turing machines, but we also can define something called a probabilistic Turing machine. And a probabilistic Turing machine is just the same as a deterministic Turing machine. The only difference is that it can generate random bits. And the way this works is, for example, like this. You know, we have the transition function in the Turing machine. And before, this transition function specified in each step, in each circumstance, what character to write at the current position on the tape. Now, we can change this, and we can give an extra option to the transition function. It can either write a character like before, or there's this extra option of writing a random character. And when I say random character, let's say it will write a 0 with probability 1/2 and a 1 with probability 1/2. So whenever you need a random bit, the Turing machine can just generate a random bit in this way. It can just write a random 0 or 1 with a 50-50 chance onto the tape at the current position and then use that random bit in the appropriate way. If you prefer not to think about Turing machines too much, you can also just think about randomized algorithms. So you have an algorithm that's just like a normal algorithm, but you can have statements in that algorithm of the type, with the 50% chance, execute statement A, and with the 50% chance, execute statement B instead. Either way, whether we talk about Turing machines, or more abstractly about algorithms, the randomization is somehow built into this concept of the Turing machine or the algorithm itself. The randomization is provided by the Turing machine or the algorithm itself. It's generated inside. The second way of thinking about randomization is that the model, like the Turing machine, remains unchanged. So we are still dealing with a completely deterministic Turing machine. Instead, the randomization is provided from outside and fed into the Turing machine. In this case, the Turing machine simply gets the normal input it would get anyway, but then it will get also a string of random bits in addition to this. And it can use the string of random bits in its computation in any way it likes. I want to emphasize that both of those points of views are completely equivalent, and there's no real difference between them in terms of what you can do. It's just a question of how you think about things and how you write them down. There are notational differences, but it doesn't really fundamentally change what you can do. Feeding random bits into a Turing machine from outside, in addition to the normal input, may seem a bit more strange at first, but actually we have seen something quite similar before. When we define the complexity class NP, what we did is we said the problem is in this class NP if we have certificates and polynomial time verifiers for those certificates. And if you think about these polynomial time verifiers, what did they really do? So they were deterministic Turing machines, and the input those machines got was the input instance of the problem, and then in addition to that, some certificate. What we are doing here with randomization is really the same. We are just replacing the certificate with a string of random bits. Let us remind ourselves what the definition of NP really was. Let's just write it down again. And now think about, instead of a certificate, we just provide a random string of bits to the certifier. What will happen? Well, if the word X belongs to the language, we know that there exists a certificate that makes the certifier or verifier accept the input. This is just the same as saying that if we provide a string of random bits, that there's a positive chance, if we find just the right sequence of random bits by chance, that the machine will accept. But if the word does not belong to the language, then no matter what input this machine gets, no matter what the random string of bits will be, the machine will always reject. So we can actually characterize the class NP in this way. It's a completely equivalent way of defining NP through the use of random bit strings rather than certificates. Okay, so these are the different types of views we can take to incorporate randomization in our computational models. All of these things are completely equivalent, so to some extent you can pick whatever way you prefer. We will often use the notation that corresponds to feeding in random bits from outside into deterministic Turing machines, but at times we will also just talk about probabilistic Turing machines or randomized algorithms, because sometimes it's just easier.